So in the last couple of days, you've heard some amazing human stories. So I want to change the subject just a little. I'd like to ask everyone here to close your eyes just for a moment, and then picture a robot. Okay, now open your eyes. I'm curious how many of you pictured something like this. This is what often people think about. And I'm curious, how does this idea get into our heads? Ever since I was a kid, growing up in Pennsylvania, I used to build rockets and robots, and I've always been fascinated by machines. But it turns out there's a long history of these kind of artificial creatures that stretches all the way back in Western culture to Pygmalion and the Golem, Frankenstein. But in the 1920s, a new word was coined, robot. And it comes from the Slovakian word robota, which in turn comes from the German root Arbeit. And it means worker. But it has a connotation, not of a pleasant kind of work, but almost a forced labor. So these robots, going back to the etymology, the original source of the word, there's a connotation that there's something about competing with us, of replacing us. So it's not surprising that we associate some kind of danger with them. Many of you remember in the 1980s when robots were very big and there was a lot of talk about the lights out factory. The idea was that we were going to put in robots and then we wouldn't need lights anymore because we wouldn't need people anymore. And as you can imagine, nowadays, in 2011, that idea of putting lots of people out of their jobs is not very popular. So what I want to talk to you about today is a change that's happening in my field, the field of robotics. RoboCop is a perfect example of what I call a robotic robot. These are robots that don't need humans. So therefore, they're dangerous. But let's look at the most exciting robots, the most successful robots over the past decade. Now we're ready for that one. Yes. The world's most popular robot is the Roomba. And at this point, there are over 5 million of these robots in homes and offices that are used to sweep and vacuum, among other things. And they're incredibly successful. The US Army has purchased over 10,000 robots like this. It's called the First Look. And these are designed to be carried by soldiers and then unpacked and thrown into a building and then teleoperated by the soldier so that they can look around and determine if it's dangerous or not. And over almost 2,000 medical robots like this, the Da Vinci, are being used in operating rooms around the world. What they do is they improve minimally invasive surgery, where you only need to make two small incisions in the body. And what they do is they allow the frame of reference for the surgeon to be automatically adjusted. They also can adjust for scale and reduce tremors, thereby increasing the precision of the operation. So these, the most successful robots in the world, all have something in common. In all cases, humans, like us, play a central role. The Roomba operates alongside humans, adults, children, and our pets. The Army's robot is operated by human soldiers, and the Da Vinci precisely follows the motions of the surgeon. Instead of competing with us, these robots cooperate with us. Now, last year, a group of researchers from Georgia Tech, Carnegie Mellon, MIT, Stanford, UPenn, and UC Berkeley got together and recreated a roadmap for research in this new direction. We recognized it as a shift from the robotic to the post-robotic. Post-robotic robots are different. They're designed to learn from and enhance human abilities. There's a kind of symbiosis. Humans and robots are interacting together. They're working and cooperating. So there are many applications of this new approach. For example, how many of you enjoy conference calls? Yeah. Well, the future of conference calls is not going to be listening on phones, a lot of voices, or talking heads, but it's going to be something like this. This is a device, it's a mobile platform. It's called a Telepresence Robot. And the idea is that you can operate it remotely from your home or office, and then you get to drive around. And from your desktop, you get to determine where you go, where you look, and who you interact with. at a remote office, at a remote office or factory or even a conference like this one. And in the past 2 years, no fewer than 6 companies have come out with telepresence robots like this one. They're not perfect, and they're still too expensive, but they suggest an entirely new role for robotics. Another example is something we call the cobot. And this is something that is designed to enhance the human skeletal muscular system. So you wear this on the human body, and it's designed to reduce fatigue and increase mobility, and can also be used for rehabilitation purposes. This particular one is being marketed by a company in Japan called Cyberdyne, and they call it the Hybrid Assistive Limb, or HAL for short. Another example is when you order books from Amazon. Somewhere out there, there's a gigantic warehouse where your books are, but they're spread out in different parts. And they have to be pulled together and assembled into a box so that they can be shipped to you. Now, Kiva Systems, a company in Boston, has come up with a new design for a robot. These are more robotic platforms that move around inside the warehouse. And human workers interact with them. So humans, like us, are very good at recognizing and grasping and loading the platforms. But the platforms are very good at navigating efficiently around the warehouse, getting from point A to point B, and avoiding collisions. What's cool about these is that these robots also share information. They talk to each other. It's a kind of social network for the robots. And over time, they learn and they improve. This is an example of a new thing that we call cloud robotics. I'm just going to grab. And in the realm of the Da Vinci, the forefront of research is on new forms of perception. So looking at different wavelengths and phosphors, how they can be used to enhance the ability of the surgeon to see and to manipulate. But one thing that's missing from the surgical robot, so far at least, is the ability to learn. So what I want to now tell you about is a project that I'm pursuing at UC Berkeley with my colleague Peter Abiel. We call it Superhuman Surgery. My father-in-law, Leonard Schlein, was a master surgeon, and I used to go with him to the operating room and watch him do these operations. And it was amazing, the complexity and the detail to be able to perform these operations. But what I also noticed was that a lot of the operation involved tedious activities, like suturing, that actually took up a great deal of the time in the operating room and were also a possible source of errors. So here's our idea. We want to outfit a robot like the Da Vinci with instruments so that we can not only follow precisely the motion of the human, but it could also record that motion. And then we want to determine a desired trajectory for the suture, for example, but we'll start with a figure 8. So here's the intended trajectory. Now we ask an expert surgeon to perform this trajectory, and here's what you see. Now this is the robot, this is the path that the robot took. And it's far better than what a novice like me would perform. But you can see that it's still jerky and imprecise. So what we do is we treat each of these paths as observations. We apply a technique from speech recognition called dynamic time warping. So we temporally align each of the paths so they line up carefully. And then we treat each of them as a noisy observation of an underlying process. And we use a variation of Kalman filtering to infer the desired trajectory and control policy that underlies the examples we saw. Then what we do is we use the control policy to execute that on the robot autonomously. We observe the results, and then we fine-tune the controls to get it more and more close to the desired trajectory. Now here's the example. This is the path the robot took operating at normal speed. Here it is at 4 times speed. Here it is at 7 times. And here it is at 10 times the speed of the demonstrations. So that's the way in which we intend it to be superhuman. It's faster and it's smoother than the best human surgeon. I also should admit to you that we did try this to push this a little further. So at 15 times speed, we started the robot off and 2 of the cables snapped off. But we've done this in a number of different scenarios. Here's an example of the robot touching. We asked the surgeon to touch four corners of a rectangle. Now, it looks clumsy, but you're operating through a robotic system. So here it is at 1x normal speed. And then here's what, after executing our procedure, we did this, now we're executing it 4x. This is completely the robot now. Here's 8x. And here's 10x the speed of the human. The details of this are in a paper that we published. And we're now working with doctors at UC Davis, UCSF, Case Western, UW, and Stanford. And what's new about this is that the robot is learning from the humans, and the humans are benefiting from the robot, because they're able to now focus on other aspects of the surgery. My father-in-law passed away before we started this project, but knowing him, I think it's the kind of project he would have really appreciated. Now, there's a few other developments in this field. Many of you know about Dean Kamen's FIRST competition that allows thousands of high school students around the country and around the world, gives them hands-on experience. But what they're actually doing is post-robotic robots. They're teleoperating these robots, and they're designed with safety in mind. And the great news for us is that it's creating a whole new generation of enthusiastic young researchers. So to summarize, in the past decade, the most successful robots have been post-robotic. So instead of competing with us, these new robots cooperate with us. Remember when you closed your eyes at the beginning and you pictured a robot? Well, if you ask a kid nowadays to picture a robot, they picture something like this. They're friendly. They think the kids understand that robots are not something out to get us, to scare us, but they're friendly. There's something that's there to cooperate. So there's a new wave, and it's building momentum. I want to show you at the end, right now, one clip of a video of an announcement that was made in June of this year.
You might not know this, but one of my responsibilities as Commander-in-Chief is to keep an eye on robots. And I'm pleased to report that the robots you manufacture here seem peaceful. At least for now. To help everyone from factory workers to astronauts carry out more complicated tasks, NASA and other agencies will support research into next generation robotics.
So the next generation of robots are ready to cooperate with each of us, with all of us. Thank you.